Welcome back to the Aces RG Dream League, live here from the DreamHack Monster Energy Studios, where Drove Ranger was trying to play pool with Finn. And we never will figure out who was winning because they're both not actually playing.
Way to just track the magic out of the situation.
That actually looks so cute, though.
Yeah, it's cute.
They are cute.
Yes. Shiver doesn't like cute things. That's inaccurate, she says.
And pulls it away. Facts, guys.
She's a fact hunter. It's respectable.
So talking about facts, we have another Dota 2 series coming up. Fact. Oh. It is Alliance versus Virtus Pro. Fact.
Oh.
Virtus Pro is a very highly appraised by loads of people, including Fog. Fact, right?
Yes, fact.
Another fact.
Why?
They look really strong. They look like I mean, we had FNG on the call too. He even said the same thing. He said that they look like they have a lot of in unison. They just look like they have a lot of teamwork. It's kind of like similar with Escape. I feel like with these guys, they might have a little bit. Maybe on a couple of the players, they have some like higher skill cap. You could say like Lil has his like very high skill cap. No one, Pasha, we've regarded them multiple times. So these guys, they do like these shiny individual plays. But overall, from what we've seen like the last like week or two from VP, has been very team oriented. So very excited.
Very excited indeed. Yes. And for this series as well, we will have another MVP poll.
Yay!
Because the poll will not start until the game is actually started. The players you can vote for are Lil with MVP 1, No One for MVP 2, Loda with MVP 3. That's not true. It's EGM for MVP 3, Loda for MVP 4. And last but not least, it is Ramses for MVP 5. All, of course, in chat with an exclamation mark before the MVP, and you're good to go. If you are forgetting these codes, which can happen because there's 5 players, 5 codes to remember, you can go to our Twitter that also will tweet the codes. It will also be in Twitch chat, though. Don't worry. It is DH Dream League on Twitter. And while you're at it, check out our Snapchat at DH Dream League, which is... hello, Draft.
Already.
Showing some behind-the-scenes footage and also anything that you might have missed from the Aces RG Dream League, including red buttons and all of the fun, funky stuff. You can also find on YouTube on youtube.com/DH Dream League, and we are in a draft. It is time for Alliance to play again, this time Virtus Pro. And Alliance, they do not change anything so far.
Nope.
They are on the dire side again. They ban out Drow Ranger again, and let's see if they will ban out Lifestealer again.
How many games were they dire yesterday? Were they dire all their games yesterday too?
I think they only swapped once.
They did swap
yeah,
once.
The last game, the game that they lost, they were actually Radiant, so.
Yeah, wait, that was the Drow Ranger game, that's right, yeah. They've been dire pretty much like five out of six games. Well, this will be the fifth.
Yeah.
So,
it's
heavy priority for them for that. The Drow Ranger, I guess after the game that they played yesterday as well, they were like, you know what, we don't want to play this hero. And Batrider, highly regarded as just a very strong hero right now. Let's see how VP responds. We have, what, the ODs left in the pool, Sand King. What is the other big one that everyone was picking?
First pick yesterday was Batrider, IO, OD, Ogre.
And Ogre, yeah, that's not...
Ogre,
I don't
yes.
think we'll see that
Let's not
VP,
forget the big Ogre pick.
Slaughter was the other one. Okay.
Ah, there he is.
So,
yeah.
Maybe a bit of a deny pick as well, because Alliance, they really like the Slaughter, and they're dire, so... And it's, I mean, it's just a really strong hero right now in the meta, so... Good pick.
What do you think is uglier? Our combined face picture, or Slaughter's face?
Oh, this is a very difficult one, actually. Well, I don't know.
That one might need another poll.
Type exclamation point hideous in the chat.
Actually,
I think that your picture is worse.
Yeah, I'm going to have to say that too. You know, we're kind of used to Slardar at this point.
At least Slardar is like in unison with himself, you know?
Indeed.
He is what he is.
He is what he is.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Well... Okay.
Yeah.
Slaughter. Oh, hey. What?
There we go. Sand King.
Okay, oh, yeah, well, so cool. Sand King is fine.
It was ignored the whole last series, so that was very bizarre to me at least. But now
and
we do.
And that's what you pick up, not the Caudill first pick?
Oh, I'm just happy to see the Sand King. They're both the same color. Maybe that's what they're going for too. It's kind of like golden.
Yeah.
They got this little golden ambiance going.
Analysis.
Okay, they definitely have a plan, though, on the Alliance. I mean, Caudill first. We know that something's up.
They're going to ban Naga. VP will definitely ban Naga at least third, fourth. That's one of the heroes. Secondary hero, I'm not too sure. But
why Nagas?
You ban our Tiny, because Tiny and Caudill work very well as well.
Oh, right? That's true. So maybe a Tiny and Naga, that could be pretty good bans. The Naga they've ran before, and that's like a pretty staple, I feel like, an aggro potential for them. They do the Coddle Naga plus one, and it's just like it's pretty devastating with all the spam.
True that.
And then Illusions, of course, with Coddle are really annoying because you can move them around so much.
Okay,
they go for a safe Disruptor pick.
Yep, nothing really surprising there. Seeing a lot of Disruptor from those CIS teams.
A lot of Disruptor coming out.
Indeed.
I like it. It's a fun hero to watch. He makes stuff happen.
Oh yeah. OD. Oops, that was the other hero that we
I mentioned him.
We've all seen so many OD games. Kind of like we can't take it anymore. He just disappears from our minds. It's that guy who's killing everybody again, right?
Yeah.
Anyone out there like OD? You guys big OD fans? Pretty underwhelmed. I mean, he's just.
I don't think I ever liked.
If I was at a bar and OD was sitting there, I wouldn't go share a drink with him. I don't care. He's just boring dude.
But he might proc another drink for you with Essence Aura.
That's a bad habit.
I reached.
That was a good one.
Okay, did you intentionally ignore the total turnaround of that conversation or not? You could have totally meant the other OD and then just started talking about that.
Yeah,
same goes for him too.
He could have also proc'd you another drink.
No, OD does not proc drinks. He sips yours when you go to the bathroom and it doesn't tell you.
He's one of them.
It's happened.
One of them.
Right. Anyway.
Hey, Mirana ban as well. And Lifestealer still removed as well, just in case.
Look at that.
Yeah,
there
good hero versus the Sanking and the Coddle, of course, because they're very magic damage based.
Can be a very good hero against Disruptor, too.
Oh.
And they actually do not ban out the Naga.
Or the Tiny. They ban out Ogre and OD. OD and Ogre? Sorry. OD and Coddle, in terms of combination synergy, is that really a thing there?
It sets up for the aggro potential, right? I guess, but I don't know. I don't.
You don't really need the extra mana, for example, if you have the Essence Aura around.
Yeah, I guess the Bloodlust is just something people are really highly favoring, but I feel like there's other heroes that kind of fit Ogre's role in a way. But whatever.
That's them scary.
Yeah, I don't want it.
Jake, what are you doing?
A tip of the old fedora to you.
That's not a fedora.
It's close to the tip of the old hat to you. Hey, it's Juggernaut.
Another Lotus staple. We haven't been seeing it get grabbed up too much. They banned it both games before versus Vega. Yeah,
yep.
They banned it from FN both games.
Nobody wants to see an FN Jug. That's death.
Yeah.
That's death on a blade, bro.
It truly is. I'm mostly curious.
I love how you still have stuff hanging from your mic.
I'm not gonna fix it now. We're too deep.
So everybody's been hyping up Virtus Pro loads. So I am expecting some crazy stuff coming out here because they've been doing some crazy stuff. Where's the crazy stuff, Fogged?
They're going to pick Doom here.
Ah.
Oh, shit. Please get it right, Fogged. Please.
If they do, I might walk out.
pretty sick. Oh. Dragonite, there's your
there
crazy
you
stuff.
Starts with a D.
Same color scheme.
Yeah.
Dragon.
Okay, well, they've... I feel like I saw that recently, too, but I don't know if it was them.
No?
But...
Why is Dragonite good here? Push a little bit of tower early game, pretty good mid game, right?
Love
late game's
armor.
Poo-poo, right? I always get that backwards. Is he good mid game or good late game, Dragonite?
Good mid game. He's good for like grouping up. If you have like an idea you want to go with, he's just very easy. He makes it easy for you. Like it's just like, okay, guys, we need to group up. DK ult, DK has six. Group up on him. Push a building. Push towers.
And
everything.
They kind of need to have that if they are expecting something like a Naga Siren, they want to go all in on that mid game. And Slaughter actually fits in that as well.
Oh, yeah, baby.
Whoa, Alliance for the Chen. this is Alliance picking Chen without Ake as well.
Yes.
So that's going to be either Hanskin or EGM. More than likely Hanskin playing it, right?
Mm-hmm, I think so.
So VP looks like they are going for a timing push, like we're mentioning. They pick up the Darkseer, which, of course, with Surge DK with Ion Shell is pretty scary. And, of course, getting your mech timing online, getting your mid-game push going.
Now, color me crazy here, but I feel like Mana Leak is going to be huge in this game.
Remember, it does cost a lot now, though.
It does.
So 150 at level 1.
It does.
But you're right, though. There's a Slardar that's going to have problems. If he's going to sprint at you, have to do is Mana Leak him. He can't do anything. A Surge will mess with you as well once you have that. So...
Dragonite too. I mean, all these heroes could seriously suffer from some Mana Leak action. This could be pretty big if he does it right. I'm going to want to see some maxed out levels of Mana Leak, at least by level 5. Come on,
Max by level 5. All right,
Would all you actually max Mana Leak here? Is the question.
I don't really think that you have the option to because you're pretty much the only D push on your team. So
if
you kind of need to get the Illuminate levels.
It's EGM playing it. There's no way he's going for Manly Max. If
no,
Hans can actually play Shen. No, he's going to be Max.
He's going to illuminate, right?
Yeah, he's going to illuminate.
Trust they need it, too. They need to be able to push the DK off the towers.
But they got Chen pushing the other lanes.
That Bounty Hunter ban?
Bounty Hunter.
They don't want it mess with the Ion Shell.
I haven't seen Bounty Hunter in a very long time. Actually, Secret played it a bit. Yeah.
Oh, he's a jungle killer, right? They want to make sure that Chen is nice and safe.
Jungle killer, any pressure is really hard. Like in that duel, we've seen it before. The Darkseer Bounty Hunter just pressures really, and Akadol suffers pretty hard from anybody. Like just like running onto his face out of the game. Like what do you do? You're fast at least, but you're very squishy.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Until level 6, there's literally nothing you can do about it. It's not good.
And so VP ban out the Razor, direct counter to the Dragon Knight. They don't want to have to see that come out. But yeah, it looks like they're going for a very mid-game type push-oriented lineup.
You know, normally I'd say that's very risky, especially against Alliance. We just saw alone in that previous game how long Alliance can stretch out a game, even if they have a shitty early to mid-game. But Virtus Pro is one of those teams that, you know, from the stories, if they're gonna have a timing push, they're gonna be a team to do it.
Oh yeah. Shit.
And they now with the Ursa, now they have three heroes that benefit from the Ion Shell, and they're all mid-game heroes. Yep. So Ursa is online, he has Blink, Slardar online, and maybe in this lineup he's online a little bit before his Blink Dagger because he has the tools from the Dragonite and the Darkseer Surge. But still, it's all mid-game oriented heroes here for the side of VP. That do even, you know, they do scale pretty decently. Like, they have great Rosh potential as well, so.
So Alliance, they have the tools to drag out a game if they want to with the Keeper of the Light. Now they only need a hero to drag it out for, I feel, because Juggernaut alone is not enough. Right? They need more
They could try to go kind of late game, or they could try to face him off in the mid game and see if they don't get there.
I'm not sure if that, like, so far with the heroes they have, can they actually do that?
What does Limp want? Limp's played what? He played Shadow Fiend recently, right? And Shadow Fiend, that does pretty decent versus DK, but I don't think he's good for, like, he needs too many items. He doesn't time well, so I don't like that at all, actually. But he has played it recently.
Yeah.
There was the TA, but that's not good versus the Ion Shell of yours.
I
didn't really think they'd pick it, but he has played it recently. So, all right, well, I eat my own words.
Okay, so...
I kind of said it.
You said it, though. You kind of said it.
You said it.
I didn't think that they would, but I thought it was, like, the most common that they've drafted recently, at least.
There you go.
I go for VP.
Okay. Woo! I said it before the series as well. I think that VP looking very strong. I'm going to go with them as well.
Oh, my Alliance curse is up. They're not going to 4-0 today. And VP picked Ursa. Their freaking symbol is a bear. Of course they're going to win. They know when to draft a bear, for God's sakes. VP for me, too.
Okay. We're all in on Virtus Pro here.
Let's lose it together. Here we go.
Here we go. We got this.
It is a game one. Alliance versus Virtus Pro. And let's see what our commentators have to say about this. It is OD Pixel and Gods.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the casting panel here at the Aces ROG Dream League. I'm Odie Pixel. I'm here with Gods, and we're ready to take you for the second series of the day. It's Alliance once again, this time up against a different CIS side. It's Virtus Pro. The draft has come out, and indeed, Fogged Wright was suggesting that last pick, Shadow Fiend. He himself questioned it a bit. Are you liking it here, Gods, or is this a tough draft for Alliance to pull off?
It's always tough to pull off a Shadow Fiend, I feel, nowadays, just because the heroes seen some nerfs, the jungle's been made harder for him, the hero just naturally kind of struggles, it seems, in today's patch, but Limp showing it can work, we've seen Escape show it can work, and I'm kind of feeling like the hero is a little bit underrated. He's not absolutely terrible, he is that situational fifth pick when you need a mid, you need some physical damage, you want a hero that can help like maybe Siege High Ground with as well, and I think with the Chen draft, with like a Jug as well, if they get a good early game, they can push towers pretty fast. I like overall the package Alliance are bringing to the table. It's just going to be whether or not they can deal with the VP aggression. Darkseer, Slada, very potent together. The Darkseer just makes all these heroes that much stronger. The Slada, the Ursa, even the Dragonite getting surged in so he can get stuns off. It's such a scary hero in VP's draft.
I mean, of course, SF, a hero that we're not too used to seeing that frequently anymore in the mid lane. I mean, DK is certainly one that's a bit of a rarity as well. You know, VP pulling it out this game, is there a reason in your mind why they did go for the DK? Yeah.
It's their only hero that hits buildings, really. Like, yep. We saw last game how bad Ursa can be at doing that. Oh, Lil.
Is he going too far? Taking a lot of damage from the Blade Fury. He should be fine, though. Cuddle, he's got Pasha blocking them off yet.
But, yeah, so DK, yeah, it hits buildings, and it's like another just tanky hero. This is kind of MVP style in some ways, where it's like the run at you and fight kind of draft, where they want to pick all these tanky melee heroes and just play super aggressive. Well, they've got four melee heroes. DK can go ranged.
Yep.
But the big thing about these four is less that they're melee and more that they're just very durable heroes that can just not be afraid to dive towers, play aggressive. They're not too worried about Chen creeps ganking them. They're not too worried about harass coming up from a Coddle, but does make the Sand King pick very strong and potent this game on Jonas's hands.
And talking about Jonas, obviously down on the bottom lane. Interesting to note that this is Alliance's first time today where they're not deciding to run Loader in the aggressive lane. Oh, well, why is that? Is that down to the heroes that VP has, or is it just Alliance trying something a bit different?
Definitely a part of it trying something different, but yep. The thing that's different is the Chen pick. You don't really want to run an aggro lane with the Chen. Chen doesn't really go into these aggro tri lanes very well. Chen is quite weak until he gets a couple of creeps. Unlike the Enchantress, level 1, you can get 2 to 3 creeps, and then you can contest the offlane. Chen, maximum 1 creep until you hit level 3. So running an aggro dual lane with a Chen in the jungle is a bit unrealistic, I feel. So the Chen pick kind of means they're going to go for more standard lanes.
Now, what can we expect to see come out from the Chen? I mean, are we going to see no one being focused on the mid lane in terms of rotations? Is that the easiest place to pull the players off?
He's a drag. I mean, that's another thing. Where you've got these tanky heroes. There's no obvious lane to gank. The Sand King has a better setup than the Shadow Fiend, so bottom lane is a bit more tempting. He's actually moved from his side to the Radiant side of the jungle, so it does look like they're going to pressure. And this is a gank solo doesn't see coming down bottom. Indeed. Chen's rocked up and say hello to First Blood.
Absolutely. Going the way of Jonas and Fan as well. He'll be incredibly happy with that. Already in this bottom lane, having a bit of a tough time against the Ursa. You know, 10 for 3 on Ramzes. Jonas and Fan just hitting a couple of CS. He's having to keep himself far away from the big old bear that's keen to get those Fury swipes stacked up. Nice little pick and rotation indeed from Hansken. And we'll just see if he's able to keep up this kind of pressure, this pace, and make himself felt evident across the lanes of VP. So sticking around and whacking into solo.
I mean, the one squishy hero is that support disruptor. Yeah. So he's like, all right, let's find the lane where disruptor's at and head that direction. It's also the lane where he's got the best ally to gank with, the Sand King. The setup's done, the caustic slow. This is the ideal lane to be at if you're a Chen.
Again, just keeping Ramzes back, making sure the Jonas and Fang can find the farm. I guess that's the thing as well. Once the Sand King gets a few levels in this lane, it's going to get harder and harder for Ramzes to farm against, especially until he hits that 6, because the caustic finale is going to hurt.
Yeah, it's a dangerous lane. And the thing is, it's one of the few melee heroes that Ursa does not particularly want to trade hits with all that well. Normally, you're okay kind of trading right clicks because of the Fury swipes. We'll see a glimpse back, saving Disruptor's life a little bit there. But against the Sand King, it's very dangerous if you're unsure as to whether he's alone. If you know he's got a friend, you definitely don't want to be trading hits, because that's where the Chen will be the difference maker in finding that kill. Sand King at bottom. I think he's actually called Disruptor. He had boots, but he didn't want to dive too hard. Had 2 in the stun. Could have hit the stun and perhaps dived to tower for the kill, but it wouldn't have been the best use of his mana and his time. He's better off just coming back and free farming the lane now that it's a 2v1.
Yeah, and of course, every time he leaves the lane to look for those kind of plays, Ramzes gets space and sitting there top of the CS board at the moment, neck and neck with Limp in the mid lane. And mid lane, of course, slightly led by Limp, but it's incredibly close. And I guess what this kind of matchup expects to be a bit of a wash. They'll trade blows, but they've both got wave clear.
Yeah. Very low levels, maybe DK can go kind of evenly. It starts to pull SF's way as he gets levels and souls. Having level 3 raises, he can just like clear waves very quickly with raises, grab runes with his bottle, and then just kind of spam out a bit better than the DK who's just got the one nuke. So SF will probably stay, maybe even pull ahead a little bit, but for now it is a wash. It's not the most exciting lane until we see rotations come, which can happen. DK hits level 6, you've suddenly got the range form stun. We do see no one pick it up before level 6, meaning that he wants to maybe have that kill opportunity with a rotation from someone like Darkseer or Slada.
Bottom lane, Hansken opting to very much cement himself down here.
I like his play so far in the Chen. Yeah. He's chosen the right lane to kind of go and sit in. Yeah, Ursa's still farming, hasn't completely shut down the Ursa by any means, but he's allowed the Sand King to get a lot of farm, and he hasn't really taken that much XP. Jonas is still about to hit level 5, 5 minutes in. This is like if you knew your offlane was going to be this farm, you'd be happy.
Oh, this wraparound from Lil. Catching Limp off guard by the looks of it. Rotates in towards the mid lane. No one does have a DD damage. One more touch will do it. Limp, no, turns around, looks for a final raise. But his own life will be raised to the ground as no one gets the touch through. EGM with the mana leak, trying to do something in return. He's going to stop no one from getting off a Dragon Tail, but Lil, maybe questioning if he could go for a bit of a pursuit. He does have the crush. Handsken's presence, making sure the VP don't find anything else there. But they'll already be happy with what they did find. Taking no one down in the mid lane, giving a bit more... Sorry, Limp down in the mid lane, giving more space to the DK and freeing it up a bit for VP.
Brings Chen mid, so suddenly bottom lane gets a lot less manageable for Jonas's Sand King, so he's going to play a bit more cautiously. Does have Arcane Boots, so can spam his stun a bit, but he's taking a decent amount of damage here. Needs to be careful.
And Jonas and Fam does have a Burrow Strike. He'll hold back the bear for the time being, but Ramsey's a couple of touches and bringing Jonas and Fam low, and they'll take the kill. Ramsey's, he's got the Enrage to help him against the damage. He actually plays his way out of this one. He looks like he might be able to. A good brief fire for Noah, minimalizing the damage that Hanska's going to be able to get out there onto to the bear. So Ramsey's gets back, and they'll take the kill for free. And in the end of the day, that play in the mid lane, pulling Hanska away from the bottom lane, allows VP to get that kill onto Jonas.
And Jonas could have gone for a run. He didn't have to go back in and fight, but either he made the call or Hanskin did. Between the two of them, they decide, let's go back in and look for these kills. Chen was coming with a couple of creeps, but fighting into the Ursa Enrage was not a winning battle for them, and Sanking was just too low before that fight even really began to truly come out on top. But again, he TP's immediately back to the lane, so it's not the worst death for him. He's still in a very good position to have a high impact with the levels and farm he's gotten. Having the Arcane Boots as early as he did and able to just pressure this lane as he's doing now is proven to be a very good start for him. And again, Jug is farming for the most part at top, has 33 CS as well. SF's farming. All three cores for Alliance are doing well. So I don't think you look at this first 10 minutes of the game and say, oh, they've done badly, they've just given up a kill to Ursa, they're in trouble. No, they're farming across the map.
And that's nice as well. Bit of play from Alliance there. Limp clearing out the stacks. VP coming in with a smoke rotation, but Alliance have already scanned it out, so they know exactly what's going on. And in fact, they may turn and try and fight. There's Lotus coming in. See what they can pull off here.
It's the Omni Slash.
And a mana indeed. They don't quite have enough mana unloaded for the Omni Slash. Meanwhile, on the bottom lane, Jonas and Fan actually able to find the kill onto Solo once again with the help of Hansken.
Nice.
And there we have VP trying for some sort of action in the jungle. Is it going to pay off in terms of kills? But it will pay off in terms of space granted for no one. Taking the mid tier one. Doesn't quite get the final touch though, but still holding on to that top spot on the net worth.
That's a key thing to do as a DK. Hero leaves your lane, push the tower. Bottom lane sanking. Go down to some Iron Shell rotations from a Darkseer, but again, tower's pushed. Damage has been done.
And Lil, we're seeing if he could maybe finish off some of the creeps there, but with a couple of nukes from a Hellbear Smasher crew, you don't want to be messing around, especially when he didn't have mana for a follow-through crush.
So both teams kind of getting what they want here in the early game.
That's
key thing is with Dragon Knight is you either need to be making successful rotations around your Dragon form or taking the tower when the enemy mid leaves. You can't just be passively farming as a Dragon Knight. That's not a hero that scales well enough like an OD or an SF that you can just sit around farming your lane and be happy. You have to be applying pressure either to your lane or to other lanes. So, so far so good for no enemies. Top of the net worth, that's good enough in itself, but even more so it's the fact that he took that T1 mid tower.
Lotus heading down to the bottom lane as well now. We'll see if he sticks around. Hanskin with the smoke. They're going to try and go for a bit of a play, but immediately, Solo dispelling the smoke and getting himself the hell out of there.
They realize someone's in the pit. They may be expecting Ursa to be in there. Yeah, they'll go in and check, but they'll find nothing. Not no one. And they don't seem to immediately realize it was warded. They may suddenly like put two and two together and think, huh, I wonder if someone was in there planning that ward and revealed it, but now it's gonna go undetected.
I mean, for Loader as well, I mean, how important is it for Alliance to find these kills at this stage? Is this gonna be a game that could go long and that benefits VP with their kind of tri-core, this Ursa, DK, Sladar, or?
This is looking more like the... Ooh, nice stun from Sand King. No follow-up though. This is looking a bit more like the Alliance we saw like six months ago, where they would just look to five man around the Chen. They had this Chen strat where they do like Chen, Lone Druid, and Jug, and just push towers non-stop and end the game by 25 to 30 minutes. And it's looking a lot more similar to that, where they've got the Jug Healing Ward, they've got the Chen who's going to be rushing a mech. The SF kind of takes the place of the Lone Druid, doesn't push anywhere near as fast, but is a tanky hero in the front lines who can hit buildings. So it reminds me a lot of that style of play from Alliance.
EP ready to kick something off big in the mid lane here. Dragon Tail onto Limp. Loader coming in with a Blade Fury. In fact, Lil falling low. Lil's down. Didn't even get the chance to get a crush off. Ramses coming in onto Limp. But a good burst strike from Jonas Avan. Holding back the Big Bear. The Epicenter coked through a couple of raises as well. And Ramses is down. No one incredibly low with the Dragon Tail. Holding back Jonas Avan. Surged away as well. Ending up being a 2-for-2. But Alliance taking two cores and a tier 1. Only losing two supports for that.
Yeah, their five man is just so strong around the sustaining from the Jug, who's maxing Healing Ward as his second spell. Hasn't got a single point in crit. He's just looking to help out his team. Chen didn't actually get a chance to use the Hand of God. He got focused down too fast, but VP kind of used a lot of spells on the supports, and then it was the SF and the Jug who just did a ton of damage.
Yeah, Loda just going in immediately onto Lil. Yeah. And he doesn't get a crush off.
Chen won that. He chain ensnared him. That was actually Chen winning him that fight, I want to say. That was some great micro coming out from Handskin, making sure that the Slada could not get close enough to the SF end time to use a crush.
Yeah, a great kind of awareness from Jonas and fam to know that he can get away with charging at the epicenter in the middle of the fight. Dragon Tail gone, no vacuum, no crush. And no glimpse to be there to worry about. You know, killing off Ramses like that in pretty much the first big fight that the Ramses turns up to. Absolutely key for keeping Alliance in this game. And 11 and a half minutes in, they're going to be potentially one of the closest we're going to have so far today.
Yep. See, Alliance has the ability to kind of storm ahead if they start taking tower after tower, taking Roshan. They are on that dire side as well. And they are looking for more pickups. They're kind of set up in position at bottom lane, but just short of a blink dagger is Jonas, so we'll see him just casually walk on in to farm it.
Ooh,
for
Ramses.
Now,
he's getting tempted by Jonas Fan.
A lot of heroes rotating in here.
He's got to be careful here. On the old pussy, was at the same time top lane.
Yeah, his team's probably giving him the memo, like VPs. They're going to the other side of the map, which means Ursa needs to be careful.
Yeah, you got VP looking at Loader. Alliance looking at Ramses. The question is if anyone's able to get the jump. Loader, does he come out and farm this wave? If he does, could be in trouble. It looks like he'll be okay, actually, because VP already pulling away from that top lane. Ramses as well, being very careful with his positioning.
Oh, they're coming back top now.
Oh, yeah, they are. They've seen Loader reveal himself with the jump. And he'll walk out the Static Storm. He's got the Blade Fury. He's just going to go for the Blade Fury TP. And nothing that VP will look to do about that one. So, Loader managing to avert the movement from VP. And indeed, at the same time, Ramses dodging the moves of Alliance. Alliance will now move into the pit. They've got pretty damn good Roshan to sieging potential at this stage of the game with the damage output from Limp and Handskin and the creeps tanking it up. And of course, this healing ward, the Loader scaling up at this stage of the game. And VP, unlikely to be able to do anything about this. This looks to be a free Rosh for Alliance.
Yeah, quick decisive play. The second they see heroes at the top tier 2, they know they've taken the tier 1 mid and the tier 1 bottom. There is no tower close to Roshan for VP to rotate to. And they kill Roche fast enough that they can do it before enough VP heroes can get there. At most two, maybe a third gets there, but they're not going to be able to assemble five heroes at the pit in time.
If they can get Ramses here, but you've got Jonas and Fan leading the charge. Didn't really have any follow-up, though, quite in time.
Other than the
Burrow Strike from Jonas and Fan, Lockdown is a little lacking for Alliance's lineup, especially in comparison to what VP have.
They want to force the five-man, though. They grouped up at bottom, they smoke. They really need to try and deal with the split push, though. No one at mid has popped the ultimate, is chipping away at this tier 2 tower. And that's something where Alliance can push very fast, but they have to respect the fact that they're going to be trading a lot of farm and XP elsewhere on the map if they're going for this all-out five-man bottom. And I think they recognize that. They're looking to gear up for a fight.
Let's see.
It's a fake out. They're pretending to be pushing.
Yeah, Hanskin's trying to work on to solo on the back line. Jonas and Fan jumping in with the initial burrow strike onto Lil. Nim's presence forcing Lil and no one to back up. They'll try for a kinetic field to hold them back, and it's
indeed
going to do that.
Anyone. They were pretending to be pushing bottom, like they left their two carries, SF and Jug, showing while the other three heroes all TP'd back. So if you're VP, you're thinking, okay, we see their two carries hitting our buildings, their supports, they're missing, but that's because they're seeing behind them in fog. No, they were ready to set up mid. One of the heroes got recalled by the Coddle, another TP'd in, but catching no one at all with a Sanking Blink, that's not the expected outcome from, in my mind, or Alliance's.
I mean, Alliance is still moving in for Morn with the Omni Slash Reloader. They're trying to find Lil. Lil kept alive by the mech heal from Pasha. Epicenter coming through for Jonas and Fan, looking for a target. Is he going to find it? Lil still alive, turns back in with a crush. And in fact, Jonas and Fan in trouble. The Amplify laid down. He'll go for the Sandstorm, but the tower's still punching into him. And Jonas and Fan, he loses his life. EGM as well, a second kill for VP. And Lil getting away just like that. They jump in, they blow the Omni, and they can't kill the Slardar as VP just juggling the side of Alliance around them and making sure that there's no casualties today on the CIS side.
VP are just outmaneuvering Alliance now. I feel like Alliance have the heroes in the draft to do all right here. Lotus gonna get found, but yeah, let's say he shouldn't be able to get solo killed by a Dragonite. That would surprise me at least. But yeah, Alliance is kind of getting pulled around and not finding efficient trades. Like, they're in a position to five-man push bottom, they come back to fight, they don't get the pickoff. They could have traded tier twos, perhaps. But again, even if they'd gone for the trade, they were already too late to go for it because VP were pushing faster. They were pushing the tier two mid faster. They could have then transitioned back to farming. They were just getting more out of the map, and Alliance need to be careful that they don't get pulled around too much at this stage of the game. Despite taking the Aegis and getting that Roshan, it feels like VP is out farming them and just one step ahead of Alliance so far.
Alliance certainly still needing that team fight. I mean, we saw there Jonas and Fan jumping in with the Epic Burrow, and the fact that he doesn't get that kill to kick it off is incredibly painful for the the follow-up outcome of the team fight from Alliance.
The Slider Sprint came up like at the exact perfect second he needed to use it and then get away on like 5 HP out of the Jug Spin range, so. Does get a little easier to fight now as Loda hits level 11. The level 2 Omni Slash just doubling in effectiveness as far as its damage output, and these fights get just that little bit more potent from Alliance when they've got more reliable damage output. Sanking the other hero you probably want to see hitting level 11 for an upcoming fight. And once those two heroes have those key levels, it gets a lot easier in general.
Looking towards Limpsbird as well, with the way that the fight's going, what, Dragonlance straight into BKB, do you feel absolutely necessary here, or do you feel this is something that Limp has kind of been forced into and he would have rather gone for other avenues on the SF?
Pretty standard for the most part, yeah. Nothing crazy about it. This is SF, when you're playing this hero, you just want to go heavy stats, tank up a lot. Nice Blinding Light helping him out there, but yeah, the BKB not going to help against the Ursa physical damage, as well as DK's pretty good against BKBs just because it's an insta-direct stun. Slaughter, another hero that has a pretty insta stun, so it's not easy to get the BKB off, but it's still like a must buy item in some ways. He would look to go for like a Skadi or a Manta, just more stats after the BKB. SF is just all about tanking up these days, and then you get the damage items like at the very end. Then even your damage items like a butterfly, which is also in some ways survivability.
No one himself also working on that BKB after the armlet.
He's still maintaining a really good level of farm with the help of a couple of towers, a couple of kills. Not often you see DKs really farming as well as we're seeing no one do, but SF is still ahead of him at this time.
Yeah, Limp. I mean, it's quite weird, really. But over the last 2 days, Limp has had amazing games, and then he's had games where he's not looked too great, but
this is the
game,
in-between,
this is
though.
Looking good.
Yeah,
this is kind of, you know, he's edging towards the kind of shining star that we're seeing. You know, if he has one fight when he's kind of cleaning up, he really could start to break ahead.
Yeah.
But Limp, he's definitely shown us that this man can pull out some miracles.
Oh yeah.
For the lineup of Alliance, absolutely crucial player and performer for the side.
Seems like Alliance are possibly gearing up for a bit of a group up play. It's really nice when you've got Coddle on your team in a push strap because you can counter push the other lanes. Like if there's like a DK solo pushing the lane, you can push it out as a Jug and then get recalled in with the Coddle. So it makes dealing with split push that much easier when you've got these five-man push strats, which is why you saw Ake used to play this Coddle a lot when they did these push strats. This time it's EG. It's still weird seeing EGM play heroes like Coddle and stuff, where I'm like, wait, where's Ake? This is his hero. But EGM holding his own on what were once the Ake heroes.
Now, Loda with the phase, Yasha, does he need to prioritize Manta? Can he get that Diffusal Blade first to add to the damage, or does he need the Manta?
There's no item like he must buy, I'd say.
Ramses, he's kind of walked into this a little bit. Plus the Enrage, he's going to try for the TP. Is the damage reduction enough? No, it's not. Alliance finding themselves a very nice freebie. Yep. Picking off the Ursa. Mid lane is being pressured in a little bit by the creeps, but Limhead's back to clear it out. And That's a massive kill there for Elias to just be able to take it and at no cost whatsoever.
Yeah, it's a nice little pickup. Does seem to be going a lot smoother for Alliance. While they didn't get a whole lot done with the first stages, they were missing a few key items, a few levels. SF to hear that just takes that little bit longer to come online and be ready to start pushing down towers, needs a couple of big items to go with the Dragon Lance, and they're giving VP to farm up their BKBs, their blinks and whatnot, but I think Alliance are just confident that once they get all their big item timings, they can just really five men down a lane and be almost unstoppable. Chen's even working on an Aghanim Scepter, so like if you can pick yourself up a couple of ancient creeps, like maybe you get a black dragon in the mix as well as one of those granite golems, your five-man siege is almost unstoppable at that point. Heroes like Ursa just don't really fight into that well at all. Darkseer can quite nicely with like a vacuum combo into a crush. The DK's got some AoE damage with his Elder Dragon form, but no one's not at that stage where he can do damage as a Dragon Knight. He's gone for the BKB as you do, but it's his next item which you normally see boost up his damage output.
Yeah, and I think I really like that choice to get the Aghanims on the chain, just to have that higher uptime in terms of when you're ready to fight. Whereas, you know, you look at VP, having a transforming hero like the DK, they're going to have to wait for the Elder Dragonfall, they're going to have to wait for the wall. And Alliance, it's going to be nice for them. And of course, they don't really need to build a pipe on the chain. That's definitely the physical damage element that's the scariest from VP rather than any sort of magical burst.
Yeah, you're right about that. Pasha in the trees, ready to jump. But also at the same time, maybe second-guessing his ability to jump into these heroes.
Bottom lane, no one actually out on his own. He'll put the BKP, go for the TP. Loader's going to try with the Omni Sash. It's not enough damage. Too many units around it.
That was a value illusion rune. He said all these like value runes this game, but when he was pushing the mid lane, he had an Arcane rune, so he had the short cooldown in his Dragon form. He had the Haste rune for that earlier mid-fight. And now he finds himself with an illusion rune that I don't know if it saves his life, but definitely made it a very comfortable TP out. Loader wasn't very close to getting that kill.
VP grouped up as five towards the mid lane. I mean, they themselves, you know, obviously talked about how Alliance, if they win a fight, the amount that they can get done. A VP in a similar position, I mean, they've obviously got the tower pushing potential of a DK. Are they looking to five-man and siege the base at this stage, or do they still need some key items?
They need more key pickoffs. Yeah. They want to find a kill into a push.
Ramsey's trying to lead in onto EGM, but again, not quite finding the lockdown. Alliance very much ready for any sort of fight that VP want to go for at this stage.
Feeling like a bit of a slower game these last 10 minutes or so, mostly just Alliance tried to test the waters with that first Aegis, couldn't do it, and it'll be more this second Aegis, which will be the perhaps key item for, I want to say Alliance, because they're the team more likely to get it, but all it takes is VP smoking, finding a pickoff, and suddenly Ursa, I mean, Ursa does what he does and takes Roshan in no time at all, so Alliance do need to maintain their discipline as far as securing this Roshan goes. And step one in doing that is going to be to go for a smoke play here. They've grouped up, they're going to loop through the enemy jungle, try and get some map control, try and find a kill, but they get found by a Radiant scan.
Very nice scan indeed for VP, and VP may want to position themselves to get ready to jump back in, and indeed so, though, hiding in the tree line. Let's see what kind of jump they get. In fact, it's going to be Jonas and Fan that gets the initial Burrow strike out onto Pashy. Limp comes in with the BKB, looks for the Requiem, gets it up, but no one has put the BKB, and he's taken down what? He's taken down two. This man, he's turned up to the fight with an ED rune. The crush comes through from Lil, not going to catch anyone. Alliance already on their way out of there, but again, another fight where, I mean, you're saying no one getting the preferential runes. It continues again with that DD allowing him to make quick work of Lim, heading straight into the Roshan pit. And Alliance, they're still hanging around. The ward's up there. VP, they're just going to jump on it. Alliance, we're trying to go for the D ward, but VP, they're going to D life. Alliance, take down EGM, and maybe move over for more. Jonas and Fan and Loader left in the lane. Go for the Burrow Strike to hold back any potential of a crush. Loader tries for the TP out in the tree line. He will make it, but again, VP with three kills, with the Roshan, with the Aegis, and now with the Blink Dagger onto no one.
Yeah, VP were just too ready for it. And as you said, no one just having a rune every single fight is just getting ridiculous. It wasn't even the best start to the fight for VP. The Static Storm prevented the follow-up from Alliance, although it didn't really fully combo anyone down. They didn't manage to burst anyone off. The key thing was Ursa on the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah.
Despite Shadow Fiend having a BKB, Ursa just went to town on him, brought him down. Even with a Requiem coming out, Ramzes manages to take most of the damage using the Enrage, and the fight just went swimmingly for VP because of the SF getting focused down at the start.
Barshep now on Ramses. And interesting enough to see Nine Pasha this game on the Darks here, building a four staff, potentially a little earlier than we used to see on a Darks here, and not necessarily the item of choice, but he's pretty rich. I guess he can go for what he wants. And I mean, other reasons why he would prioritize a four staff this game.
One of those items that's just always great on utility heroes, like having four staffs to save teammates, push him around, get DK in for a stun.
Yeah.
And there's like never really a bad game for a four staff. This game, it's not like amazing against any certain like specific one spell necessarily, but it's just a great all-around item. Would like to see him upgrade to the Greaves. The cooldown reduction on the heal from 65 to 40 is great. And also it helps get rid of the mana leak. If it happens to get thrown on yourself, you can Greaves it off. So it does make life as a Darkseer a little bit better.
Innocent fan hiding in the trees. We'll see if it does go for any kind of solo play onto solo, but no, Disrupts is already out. And Alliance, yeah, definitely will have been shaken up a little bit after that last engagement. Need to pull themselves together. Limp, BKB, Dragon Lance, Yasha as well. And by the looks of it, you imagine just what getting the Manta style to help him out against the Amplify from the Slardar in these fights?
Yeah. SMY seems like a odd pickup at this stage. Okay. I don't think it's SMY. I think it's much more likely Manta.
Yeah.
I think that getting out of the amp, and if you get like jumped on by Nursa, you Manta style, and it just creates that momentary confusion where he's not doing damage to you. And
or talking about the SF, he has been jumped on. Okay. He is beefy. Between the two of them, they can't kill him. So Limp will be fine. It's going to be Glimpse back. It just actually pops the BKB. So, I mean, that Glimpse maybe not necessarily going to set them up for a kill, but just spooking Limp, forcing him to pop a BKB charge. Lil continues to jump in on a bit of a chase down, but he's not going to be able to catch Innocent Fan. He's already out of there. Loader, he's going for the wrap. Pushing down on the bottom lane. Ramses will turn up. Maybe see if he can chase down Loader into the tree line. Oh, what's he going
to
do here?
Needs to blink.
He's... Loader. Maybe should have Blade Fury TP'd earlier.
There's a basher. That's the problem. It's really smart that it's Ursa TPing in because...
Yeah.
One, the Blade Fury is on cooldown, but even when it comes back up, there's no teeping away from the Basher Ursa. And that's a big reason why he goes into that Basher, is because he knows if Loader wants to split push, the Blade Fury TP is his escape from that rotation, from the Glimpse, from the Slider TP. I mean, Slider has Bash himself, but you're unlikely to get off. Slider Bash is unreliable because you hit so slowly. Ursa Bash is almost guaranteed.
Painful loss there for Alliance again. It's starting to fall apart a little bit for them here in this game. 27 minutes. You know, Limp's still in a good position, but VP just kind of making the better calls at this stage, as Alliance can't afford to let any of these kills go away again. Yonis Fan jumping in on top. Nunpash is out of there. Alliance actually sweeping through their jungle. We'll see if they catch anyone out. Solo in the nearby neighborhood. Doesn't look like he'll get too close for comfort. He'll be fine. Yeah. Pasha could be the target. Jonas and Fan setting up the Yules. We'll see if he can play his way out of this one. A fair few members of Alliance coming in, surrounding the Darkseer. He's actually just going to go for the TP out. In fact, he's a bit of a genius. What are you going to do about that? We talked about it earlier. Alliance lacking the lockdown other than the Sand King stun, and it's shown there. Lil's going to come in with a crush onto two. Ramses rips EGM to pieces. Oh my goodness. And we saw Lil trying to go for another crush, but the TP out was already there. Jonas, but it's getting scary. You know, Amplify into the power of the Fuzzy Wuzzy. It's a kill every time for VP, and very quickly as well.
Yeah, they're just playing their draft really well, finding kills so with ease. And that's something Alliance have tried to do. They know that in order to take Roshan or to go push, it's a lot easier to do if you can smoke, find a pick off, and then go from there. But VP, they scatter them out with the scans when they've smoked. They've just not found any connections past the early game. They got some kills early on with the Chen down bottom, but it feels like Alliance are just not finding any kills at all here in the mid game.
Oh, Lil coming in, jumps in. There's the vacuum wall drop down as well. The Static Storm. Lil just blown up here in the midst of it all. They managed to catch out the Jonas and Fan as well. Loader came in with the Omni Slash, but it really did not do a lot at all. Glimpse back onto Handsken. It's going to be a third kill for VP in this push. They'll move on to the racks. And GG's called. It's just fallen apart all too quickly for Alliance. VP to take the first game. Alliance showing a fair bit of solidarity in the earlier stages, especially in the laning stage. It didn't look too bad, but as soon as the team fights came together, VP were much clearer in pulling off the successful objectives, and Alliance just kind of torn all over the place at the end of that one.
Yeah, they had a lot of fun with the Shadow Fiend, but it didn't really feel like Shadow Fiend was a threat or ever that scary. He was top of the net worth for like most of the game, but you need so many items on that hero to work, and you also need to your team to like play around, death ball around you really well. VP just kind of pulled them apart, found pickoffs here, over there, and the big team fight with that smoke before when the second Roshi spawn was like that. That's just
that scan. Yeah. That scan, of course, as you mentioned. You know, they scan it, and they were ready for it. They turn it around. And yeah, VP, obviously a lot of people coming into this one saying, look out for VP, and we are seeing indeed here how well these boys can play. Alliance, though?
Not all bad news. I mean,
there was good, you know, keeping up in a game where there's this kind of pace. The fact that he was able to find the farm that he had was pretty impressive, but as you said, he just needed more time, really. He needed that one extra item to be able to actually do enough in the fights.
I think the good takeaways is like Hanskin played a really good chain, put a lot of pressure down bottom. They were a bit unlucky maybe with a couple of the runes that no one had, the Omni Slash down bottom where they also don't get the kill. If they just found a few extra kills with some of those rotations. The other big one was when they TP'd back to the tier 2 mid after they had the first Aegis and killed no one. That was like, wait, by no one I mean they absolutely didn't kill
anyone on the defense.
What happened? You five-man rotate to defend the tower when you have you're the team who's ahead. You have Aegis, you have the catch of a Sand King, you have an Omni Slash. You're meant to be finding plays, either towers and objectives, getting map control, or finding kills, winning fights. And they TP back, they lose map control, they don't find any kills. That right there was a really odd sequence of events. I don't know where things went wrong, but that was a big waste of time. They actually lost like 1,500 to 2,000 net worth lead while they had Aegis. And I'm just like, they should be increasing their lead when you have Aegis. So
it was
a good game from Alliance, just a lot to learn from it, and a takeaway, I think.
Yeah, and we'll see if they're able to take anything away from themselves, bring it back in the game too. Of course, pretty much the last few series we've seen Alliance go, they've always been able to pull off a draw. We'll see if that's going to be the case here as one more game comes today. VP once again to go against Alliance. Yeah, but for now, we'll head over to a short break, then to the panel, and then back to us for the final game, VP versus Alliance. VP standing 1-0 at the moment.